Okay, let's move on to step three. Let's turn to page 59. Page 59, and we'll read step three. Made a decision to turn our will and our lives over to the care of God as we understood Him. First paragraph on page 58. Paragraph 1, page 58. For this alcoholic, this is the most important thing for me to hear every meeting I attend. Where it says, rarely have we seen a person fail who has thoroughly followed our path. Notice that there is no S on path. Have you heard, there are a lot of different ways you can do this program. That's not what my book says. You know what thoroughly means? According to Webster's Dictionary, it means to complete. So in other words, if I want to experience what the authors are experiencing when they talk about new power, new peace, new happiness, new direction, being happy, joyous, and free, being in a position of neutrality, safe and protected, the problem has been removed, I stop fighting everybody and everything, I have to be willing to do what the authors are doing. If I'm not willing to do that, I will not. It's guaranteed. I've had personal experience with it. Not thoroughly following this path. Working half measures in the rooms of AA. So if I want what they have, I have to be willing to do what they're doing. Then they go on to say, those who do not recover are people who cannot or will not completely give themselves to this simple program. Here the authors are telling me why I don't stay sober. Why am I not happy, joyous, and free? Because I cannot or will not completely give myself to this simple program. In other words, am I willing to ask God to take it away for good? Not just today, but for good. Am I willing to quit for good? Every single person that I've ever taken through the steps has had the same experience that Bill Wilson had. And this is basically what happened to me. It's basically the same thing that happened to Bill. As a result of going through these steps, I had a spiritual experience. In other words, the compulsion to drink was removed. I was separated from alcohol. And as a result of that, God made a deal with me. He said, I'll tell you what. He said, I will guarantee that you will never, ever have to drink again, and you will never have to live it the way you have been living. And all I ask is that you take this message of hope and pass it on to others. It's a done deal. To make that kind of a deal with a real alcoholic. Because I came in here with the desperation of a drowning man. I could not stop drinking. I could not stop hurting myself and everybody around me. So when that happened as a result of going through the steps, that sounded like a pretty good deal to me. And I'm here to guarantee each and every person in this room that you do not ever have to drink again. And you do not ever have to live the way you've been living. Now, it doesn't matter if you're brand new in sobriety or if you've been around the rooms for a while. Even if you've been around the rooms for a while and you don't like the way your life is going, I can guarantee you, you don't have to live that way anymore. Okay, let's go to the next paragraph. Line 3. So we're at paragraph 2, page 58. Line 3. If you have decided you want what we have and are willing to go any length to get it, then you're ready to take certain steps. So let's turn those into questions. Notice that the authors aren't saying, do you want what we have? That's a thieves' motto. I want what you have. I want your stuff. That's a thieves' motto. That's not what it's saying. It's saying, if you have decided, in other words, have you made a decision? If I've decided that I want what you have, I'm making a decision, I'm going to do what you're doing. So the people that are new in this room, when you go to meetings and you see people with long-term sobriety and they seem to be enjoying life, to have what they have, you have to be willing to do what they're doing. So I have to ask myself that question. Have I made that decision? And are willing to go to any length to get it. Doesn't say most links, a lot of the links. It says any link. Turn that into a question. Are you willing to go to any link? Then it goes on to say, then you are ready to take certain steps. I had an experience early on with my sponsor when I was faced with this proposition. And basically what happened was my self-will had taken over my life again in sobriety. And I was experiencing a great deal of unmanageability. I was suffering. I was a prey to misery and depression. I didn't feel like I could be of real help to other people. And I didn't know which way to turn. And I ended up meeting him at a coffee shop. We met there for breakfast, and it was the breakfast rush hour at this particular restaurant. And he asked me those questions. Are you willing to go to any length to have a spiritual experience? He asked me. I said, yes, I am. He said, are you willing to go to any length? I said, yes, I am. He said, therefore, get on your knees in this aisle right now and ask God for help. And that's what I did. I got on my knees. I mean, the waitresses are going back and forth, you know, dish right next to the kitchen. You can hear the clanging of the dishes, you know, and the hustle bustle of the morning breakfast rush. You see, I was willing at that point. Next time you're having difficulty in sobriety and you're in a public place, stop and ask yourself that. Would I be willing to get on my knees right here, right now, and ask God for help? Because remember, I'm a real alcoholic. No human power can produce that essential psychic change. I don't have the power, and you can't give it to me. I have to find it from a God of my understanding. Okay, page 59, second line from the top. Page 59, second line from the top. But there is one who has all power. That one is God. Did you notice my name is not in there? It doesn't say, but there are two, and one of them is Paul. It doesn't say that. It says there is one who has, doesn't say most of the power. Doesn't say he has majority of the power. It says all the power. Once again, I'm not the smartest kid on the block, but I didn't put this much together. If God has all the power, how much does that leave for me? None. I don't have any of the power. I am basically a foot soldier. That's what I am. The power doesn't originate in me. Okay, page 60. Page 60, and we're going to read the ABCs. The ABCs on page 60. A, that we were alcoholic and could not manage our own lives. B, that probably no human power could have relieved our alcoholism. C, that God could and would if he were sought. Let's turn those into questions. Now we're going to make a shift. Now the authors are asking me, do I believe? So ask these questions of yourself. Do you believe you're an alcoholic? Do you believe you can't manage your own life? Do you believe no human power can relieve your alcoholism? Do you believe that God could and would if you seek him out? In the very next line, the authors say, being convinced, we were at step three, which is that we decided to turn our will and our life over to God as we understood him. Just what do we mean by that, and just what do we do? Being convinced, convinced of what? Well, convinced of the ABCs. Let's ask that question. Are you convinced that you're an alcoholic? Are you convinced that you can't manage your own life? Are you convinced that no human power can relieve your alcoholism? Are you convinced that only God can if you seek him out? Next, the authors say the first requirement. I heard that there were no requirements for step three. That's what I heard. And yet the authors say right here, the first requirement is that we be convinced that any life run on self-will can hardly be a success. I'm going to read this in the first person to receive some perspective. So I'm no longer reading about some guy in a book and his experience, but I'm going to turn it into first person so I can get a personal perspective. Follow along with me, if you will. The first requirement is that I be convinced that my life run on self-will can hardly be a success. On that basis, I am almost always in collision with something or somebody, even though my motives are good. I try to live by self-propulsion. I'm like an actor who wants to run the whole show, is forever trying to arrange the lights, the ballet, the scenery, and the rest of the players in my own way. If my arrangements would only stay put, if only people would do as I wished, the show would be great. Everybody, including myself, would be pleased. Life would be wonderful. In trying to make these arrangements, I may sometimes be quite virtuous. I may be kind, considerate, patient, generous, even modest and self-sacrificing. On the other hand, I may be mean, egotistical, selfish, and dishonest. But as with most humans, I'm more likely to have varied traits. What usually happens? Show doesn't come off very well. I begin to think life doesn't treat me right. I decide to exert myself more. I become, on the next occasion, still more demanding or gracious, as the case may be. Still, the play does not suit me. Admitting I may be somewhat at fault, I am sure that other people are more to blame. Of course they are. I become angry, indignant, self-pitying. What is my basic trouble? Am I not really a self-seeker even when trying to be kind? Am I not a victim of the delusion that I can wrest satisfaction and happiness out of this world if I only manage well? Is it not evident to the rest of the players that these are the things that I want? And do not my actions make each of them wish to retaliate, snatching all they can get out of the show? Am I not, even in my best moments, a producer of confusion rather than harmony? I am self-centered, egocentric, as people like to call it nowadays. I'm like the retired businessman who lolls in the Florida sunshine in the winter, complaining of the sad state of the nation, the minister who sighs over the sins of the 20th century, politicians and reformers who are sure all would be utopia if the rest of the world would only behave, the outlaw safecracker who thinks society has wronged him, and the alcoholic who has lost all and is locked up. Whatever my protestations, am I most concerned with myself, my resentments, and my self-pity? Of course I am. Selfishness, self-centeredness, that I think is the root of my troubles. Driven by 100 forms of fear, self-delusion, self-seeking, and self-pity, I step on the toes of my fellows and they retaliate. Sometimes they hurt me, seemingly without provocation, but I invariably find that at some time in the past, I have made decisions based on self, which later placed me in a position to be hurt. So, my troubles, I think, are basically of my own making. They arise out of me, and I am an extreme example of self-will run riot, though I usually don't think so. Above everything, I must be rid of this selfishness. I must, or it kills me. God makes that possible. And there often seems no way of entirely getting rid of self without his aid. I have had moral and philosophical convictions galore, but I could not live up to them, even though I would have liked to. Neither could I reduce my self-centeredness much by wishing or trying on my own power. I had to have God's help. So here on page 62 in paragraph 1 and 2, what we have is the problem. The problem is my selfishness, my self-centeredness. My troubles are of my own making. We all have issues, don't we, in sobriety? I have lots of issues, too. And you know what mine are? They're on this page. These are my issues. Selfishness and self-centeredness. So, a couple of questions to consider. Are you willing to consider that selfishness and self-centeredness is the root of your troubles? Are you willing to consider that your troubles are basically of your own making? Now, that being the case, I'm going to show you a shortcut. The next time you're calling your sponsor and you want to whine about something, just cut the chase and call them up and say, hey, I want to whine about me, okay? Instead of complaining about everybody else, check it out. I just conceded that selfishness and self-centeredness is the root of my troubles. And that my troubles are basically of my own making. That being the case, and I bring a trouble to you, who am I complaining about? I'm complaining about me. Is that wild or what? That is wild. And the authors are telling me that I'm driven by 100 forms of fear, self-delusion, self-seeking, self-pity. Now, If I'm driven by self-delusion, how am I going to know if I'm self-deluded? No, it's not a trick question. I'm not going to know. That's like going to a fish and asking it, what is water? It will say, well, you know, it's everywhere. That's how self-delusion is in my life. It's everywhere. In other words, I'm not going to know when I'm self-deluded. Why? Because I lack power. That's the reason I repeatedly go through the steps and maintain the disciplines of self-examination and rely on people around me to hold me accountable. Because I'm not capable of knowing when I'm self-deluded if I'm driven by self-delusion. See what a trap it is? Yeah, I know what I need to do. I know what's best for me, certainly. I don't know what's best for me. I still don't know what's best for me today after 20 years of sobriety. If I knew what was best for me, I wouldn't be maintaining these disciplines. It was not in my plans to stay sober this long. I came in here to prove to you people these 12 steps do not work. That was the purpose of going through the steps the first time. I was going to prove to you that they do not work. What that illustrates is it doesn't matter how much disbelief or doubt that I have. By doing the actions of these principles, they began to work for me. I wasn't working them. They began to work for me. By the time I got to the end of the steps, I had a spiritual experience. The compulsion to drink was removed, and my attitude was totally different. I didn't intend on sticking around these rooms. I just wanted to buy a little bit of time, get people off my back, stay out of jail. When I got to the end of the steps, my thinking changed. I wanted to stick around. If I had known I was going to be sober this long, I would have done a much better job along the way. Okay, so we have the problem in paragraph 1 and 2. Now let's look at the solution. It's in paragraph 3, the same page. This is the how and why of it. First of all, I had to quit playing God. It didn't work. Next, I decided that hereafter in this drama of life, God was going to be my director. He is the principal. I am his agent. He is a father. I am his child. Most good ideas are simple. And this concept was the keystone. Here's that arch again. The keystone of the new and triumphant arch through which we pass to freedom. A couple of points here. Keystone in that arch. The cornerstone is the first brick. The keystone is the brick in the middle of the arch, which holds it together. So my cornerstone, my beginning, is my willingness to believe in a power greater than me. And my keystone, which is what holds it together, is that I need to stop playing God. Do you have a partnership with God today? I thought so at one time in sobriety. You know what partnership means? It means equal position of power. Now, if he has all the power, how can that be a partnership? If you work for someone else, are you in partnership with your employer? No, probably not. You do the work, they pay you, and everything you need is provided for you. Is that accurate? That's been accurate in my life. Okay, providing that we do the solution, which is stop playing God, what that basically means is that I'm going to do God's work. What is God's work? Well, we're going to find out. These are the third step promises. Top of page 63. Page 63. When I sincerely took such a position, the position they're talking about in the previous paragraph on page 62, all sorts of remarkable things followed. We had a new employer being all powerful. He provided what we needed if we kept close to him and performed his work well. Established on such a footing, we became less and less interested in ourselves, our little plans and designs. More and more, we became interested in seeing what we could contribute to life. As we felt new power flow in, as we enjoyed peace of mind, as we discovered we could face life successfully, as we became conscious of his presence, we began to lose our fear of today, tomorrow, or the hereafter. We were reborn. Wow, that's pretty powerful. Look at the guarantees involved in that paragraph. It has been my experience that God does not have any favorites, but I'll tell you what, He pays His workers really well. He pays them really well. So, if I'm willing to take the solution in the last paragraph on page 62, I will experience what it says in the first paragraph on page 63. Now, the authors are telling me that we were reborn. You know what that means? It means I have to die. The Paul Fisher that I know of had to die. Paul Fisher, the alcoholic, had to die so that my spirit may live. I'm told that I'm not the same person I was when I walked into these rooms. I hope not. Because he wasn't wrapped too tightly. Because I just was not really well liked around the rooms. You know, early on my friends referred to me as stark raving sober. Because that's what I was. I was out of control. My life was unmanageable. I was trying to run the show myself. So here we're being asked to make a decision. Am I willing to make a decision to turn my will and my life over the care of God as I understand it? Now look at those words, will and life. We write wills, don't we, before we die? You know what a will does? It gives people instructions on what to do. So if I'm going to turn my life over to the God of my understanding, I'm going to ask for instructions. My life, I'm going to do things according to what I believe God would have me be. And we're told later in the book, in step 12, what our real purpose is in these rooms. See, the real work is not doing the first 11 steps. The real work is step 12. The first 11 steps prepare us to do the real work. See, that deal I made with God, He guaranteed that I'll never have to drink again. And all He asked me to do was take this message of hope and carry it to other alcoholics. Best game in town for an alcoholic. Best game in town. So now we're at step 3. Before we read the third step prayer, I'm going to ask those that are willing to participate to go ahead and let's read this together. Just to pause for a moment before we do so. And to give some serious consideration if you're willing to make this decision. My own experience with the third step was that I was never the same after I took the third step as instructed in this book. It may have been subtle, but it was different. It was never the same after that. You can see I'm making a decision here that I'm going to give my life to that God. After all, He's going to give me, they just got through telling us He's going to give us everything we need. So those of you that are willing to take the third step prayer, those that are comfortable, feel free to kneel. Go ahead and do so now. Those that are not comfortable, don't feel obligated to do so. We'll take a moment. Asking for direction and care. God, I offer myself to Thee, to build with me and to do with me as Thou wilt. Relieve me of the bondage of self, that I may better do Thy will. Take away my difficulties, that victory over them may bear witness to those who have Thy power, Thy love, and Thy way of life. May I do Thy will always. Amen. Congratulations. In the next paragraph, the author states, we found it very desirable to take this spiritual step with an understanding person, such as our wife, best friend, or spiritual advisor. But it is better to meet God alone than with one who might misunderstand. The wording was, of course, quite optional, so long as we express the idea, voicing it without reservation. This was only a beginning.